What were your first thoughts when you read the Morbidity and Mortality Weekly report with these mysterious cases that you would later find out were AIDS?
I remember it as clear as yesterday. I was sitting in my office over at the NIH Clinical Center, where my office was at the time, and the first MMWR that came out on June 5th of 1981 was of five gay men from Los Angeles who presented with pneumocystis pneumonia. Now, I had been an infectious disease specialist for several years prior to that, and was quite familiar with pneumocystis pneumonia. And it just struck me as an oddity that otherwise healthy men, and another oddity, otherwise healthy gay men, got an infection that you virtually never see in someone with a normal immune system. We had seen a lot of it in cancer patients who were getting chemotherapy and were getting their immune system suppressed, and we were called as infectious disease consults to see them. So I was familiar with the circumstances that you get pneumocystis pneumonia. And I just sort of scratched my head and said, boy, that's an oddity. Then the real crusher came 1 month later when another MMWR came on describing now 26 men, not only from Los Angeles, but from San Francisco and New York. Again, curiously, all gay men, not only with pneumocystis pneumonia, but with Kaposi sarcoma and other opportunistic infections. And at that point, it was like, oh my God, we're dealing with something new. My whole career and my life changed because I decided that this was important enough for me to change what I was doing and start pursuing this disease that didn't even have a name at the time, much less an etiology.
What is it like for someone who has been diagnosed with HIV today compared to 1981?
Well, the difference between now and 1981 is just night and day. Back then, when I started to admit these young, mostly gay men with this strange disease, which we began calling GRID, or gay-related immune deficiency, even before it got the name AIDS, they usually came to you after they had developed advanced disease because we didn't have any diagnostic tests, so they didn't know they were sick until they really got sick. So when they came in to see us, the median survival of those people was anywhere from a year to a year and a half, a dreadful, dreadful prognosis. Today, with the development of a wide array, about 30 or more drugs, which when used in combination and given to a person relatively early in the course of their infection, that you can now get a life expectancy that approaches normal. What's happened and transpired from 1981 to now is really one of the most extraordinary accomplishments in biomedical research.